In this section, Glassy discusses his work in the Chesapeake Bay, where he recorded every house and drew carefully measured plans. There is the eye house with two stories high, one room deep. It had a bilaterally symmetrical facade hiding the interior, and you entered into an unheated, unlit corridor. Then there's the shift to the parlor house, which was a compositional move of massing from organic to the geometric, and there was an asymmetrical array of openings that revealed the interior. In New England and Virginia, there were similar parlor house typologies, but in New England, the chimney was located in the middle, and Virginia was on either end. This is, again, noting the environmental decision based on location. The chimney in the center was used for heating in cold climates, whereas in the warmer climates, the chimneys at either ends left the open center for circulation. The salt box house is a facade with perfect tripartite bilateral symmetry. You enter into a vestibule and the service wing gains access to the central chimney. In future designs, there will be a second kitchen, which is different from the room used for entertainment. And this is the moment when gender roles of modern time come into being. The types of these homes convey the social order. A smaller house was not a miniaturized version of a larger one. It was a full-scale fragment of a big house. Based on the change he learned in Virginia, he wanted to apply this to Ireland. He was aware of the writings of Easton Evans, where it was described Ireland into two architectural regions. The houses in the east, where the English had settled, had a central chimney and linear plans. And then the houses on the west had chimneys on the ends, like the hall and parlor houses of Virginia. His hypothesis was that along the border in Western Ireland, the houses would change from open to closed, and from asymmetrical to symmetrical at the beginning of the 20th century. While the forms he found there were not like what he predicted, the old house was socially open and asymmetrical, but in functional terms, the change in Ireland was precisely like the change in Virginia. It was easier for him to construct the motives of history, though, in Ireland, because he could talk to people and still had a greater access to the traditional buildings, so therefore they could be easily dated, and here he was able to refine his ideas. And this allows him to define the arrival of modernity. Also in this chapter, he discusses the private-public distinctions that occur in the houses, which was mentioned earlier. His survey of the 19th century in America, which has been studied less, as Upton points out, than the 18th century, because either people think that the 18th century just continued its particular style, and there was an influx of written documents, which provided or accounts for less fieldwork, which Glassy is upset by. The 18th century was a time of convergence, whereas the 19th century was a time of divergence. And here are the patterns that Glassy notes for the 19th century. One, it was a pattern of continuity. Or two, it was an extension of the 18th century process into a new territory. Three, was the dismantling of the 18th century accomplishments. They built eye houses, but it diminished the bulk. The fourth pattern is a fresh design. It's a blending the old with the new, kind of starting with the dismantled 18th century plan and coming up with something new. Five, one of continuity unconnected to the developments in Virginia and Massachusetts. The sixth is a pattern of books, where there are published books of advice for homes. And finally, the seventh pattern is selected ideas from books, but then mix them up in order to create a practice of accommodation and excitement. In conclusion, Glassy notes the three great periods of vernacular architecture. There's the period of the village, where time of compressed housing and dispersed fields. There's the period of the house, where the big buildings were not religious but political. The ownership of the land solidified, resulting in the house also becoming solidified. It was rebuilt in permanent materials, a real sense of ownership. And the third period is of commodity, where the big buildings do not belong to religion or politics, but to business. Houses become commodities through ornamentation, through things made by other people. In this section, he has a call for research. The study of vernacular architecture should include patient ethnographic investigation of how commodities are assembled into domestic environments. And he states the goal is to develop a method of comparison free from mere chronology that will help us understand general principles of historic action through the study of material culture. He uses architecture to illustrate how material culture can be read.